I urge you, brothers and sisters, that there be no division among you, but that you be united in the same mind and in the same purpose. As you can imagine, people come to me from time to time and want to speak to me. Father, do you have a couple of minutes? Okay, can I make an appointment to see you? And a lot of times it's something about some problems or difficulties that they may have been having some time. And often these problems or difficulties revolve around what a lot of our problems and difficulties revolve around, relationships, right? Okay, and quite often has to do with a relationship in their marriage or marital struggles. And I don't have to tell all of you that are married out there that marriage can be just a tremendous blessing, but it is also a tremendous challenge at the same time. And as much of a blessing as it is, it's not easy. And it never has been and never will be. And for a whole myriad of reasons, many marriages, or many romantic relationships for that matter, failed, resulting in one or both of the parties wanting to go their separate ways. And while every marriage is unique, the problems that different couples have can be quite similar. Some of the problems are like infidelity, of course, is a big problem, and it causes a lot of relationships to break up. Abuse, both physical and emotional, sadly, is also a significant factor in the breakup of relationships. Even something as simple as and common as boredom can creep in and threaten a relationship. There's also another that oftentimes I hear, and it'll go something along the lines of that. I don't know where we are anymore. I think we're in different places. You know, in the end, I guess we just want different things out of life anymore than we did before. So in the end, I guess we just wanted different things out of life. Then we go back to the verse that I began with, that we have from St. Paul today. He says, I urge you, brothers and sisters, that there be no division among you, but that you be united in the same mind and in the same purpose. I don't have to tell you that there are a lot of things that divide us, isn't there? And there's a lot of division within Christianity itself. And I don't just mean simply different denominations that fall under Christianity, although being part of different denominations can be, you know, a problem that when it comes to division. But what I'm really talking about is the enormous differences that seem to exist within the hearts and the minds of individual Christians. And this is nothing that is new, nor is it something that just came about. And it's nothing that just came about as a result of, you go back to the year 1054, where there was a huge division in the church between the East and between the West, when we had a formal split of the church between what is now called the Orthodox Church compared to the Latin Rite or the Roman Church. Or I'm not even talking about the divisions that occurred maybe about 500 years later in the Protestant Reformation, resulting in a rapid splintering of our faith communities. But the reality is that ever since the beginning, Christianity, as well as many other things, but Christianity has always been sometimes contentious, as a faithful and church leadership have tried to clarify and define and figure out what it means to be Christian, and therefore try to find a way to be united in that same mind and purpose. That people who claim to be outside of organized religion often criticize organized religion. Why? Because you're part of Christianity, you're Catholic. What positive difference in the world does your religion make? To me, when I see different religions, people that stand outside of organized religion, they say, all I see are these different religions or cults or sects that give rise to violence or hatred or all kinds of unsavory things. They'll say that Christians are no different than anything else. Christians are just a cross-section of society as a whole, and they accuse us of pursuing all the same worldly things, having all the same problems and divisions that everybody else has. They're no different. You may say one thing, but you live a different way. So from the outside looking in, what they're saying is that our religion or our faith or Christianity is some kind of hypocrisy. And sometimes it looks like that from the inside too. You know, the complaint that I can hear is that if Christians live just like everyone else, then what difference does it make to be a Christian? Well, when you put it that way, it'd be hard to come up with some kind of reasonable response. And I think people who feel this way, sadly, may be onto something. And maybe we shouldn't dismiss them so lightly. Like much of society, maybe each of us wants different things out of life. So then what is St. Paul driving at when he's talking to the people of Corinth to be united in the same mind, to be united in the same purpose? Aren't we different? Isn't it okay to have different attitudes or outlooks or opinions about things? Isn't it ridiculous to believe that we can all be the same, or think the same, or want the same? So what is St. Paul trying to get at? I think the answer to that lies in his carefully chosen words. Same mind and same purpose. Seemingly implicit in that phrase from St. Paul is the idea that mind and purpose that he's talking about lies outside of ourselves. In other words, if we truly want to be united in faith, it's not okay for me to just listen to what my mind wants or simply follow what is my own purpose. And if that were the case, and unfortunately oftentimes it is, Christians would be just as divided as everyone else, because each of us goes our own way, does our own thing, and we suffer because of it. You know, not unlike a married couple who find themselves no longer on the same page on so many important things, they suffer, and the world suffers because of it too. The same mind and purpose that St. Paul talks about, of course, is the mind and purpose of Jesus Christ. And one of the unique promises of Christianity is that our faith is not predicated on, built on, some type of philosophical system. Our faith is built on, founded on, rests on, is grounded in a person, the person of Jesus Christ, our loving God, our God who became one like us, and our God who remains with us always. And we as Christians aren't Christians because we follow a few ideas or a few rules or do a few practices. Rather, we are Christians because we follow a person, a concrete person we can look to who shows us how to live, why to live. He shows us how to see, how to think about things, and how to act. And so being a faithful disciple has nothing to do with figuring out what I want in life. Being a faithful disciple is about what God wants out of my life, what God wants out of us as a faith community. And what God wants from us is the things that will last. These are divine things. These are the God things. These are the things that have the power to transform human hearts and to transform the world. What are these things that God is asking us to unite with? These are things like unconditional love, radical forgiveness, unbounded generosity, true compassion, mercy, understanding, If we can't agree on these simple things, can we really claim to be united in faith? And what do we have to sadly admit that our critics are right? Most of us hate inconsistencies in the hearts and minds of people, especially people of other faiths. Let us strive to make sure that we don't have those same things happen within Christianity, within our parish community, within our lives, and that we have the same mind and the same purpose as Jesus Christ.